Good afternoon. The first item of business is portfolio questions on constitution, external affairs and culture. I would ask those members who would wish to seek to ask a supplementary question to please press the request to speak button during the relevant question or enter the letters RTS in the chat function. As ever, I would appreciate succinct questions and answers in order to get in as many members as possible, and I call question number one, Alistair Allen.
To ask the Scottish Government what contact it has had with the UK Government regarding concerns over the potential impact in Scotland of the proposed illegal migration bill.
Cabinet Secretary Angus Robertson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I wrote to the United Kingdom Government stating unequivocally that the Scottish Government do not support the bill, which removes offering a place of safety to desperate people fleeing conflict and persecution, and have urged them not to progress with the bill. The First Minister has echoed this during First Minister's questions, condemning the cruel and inhumane provisions in the bill. We have a moral obligation to offer a place of safety to people fleeing conflict and persecution, both because it is enshrined in international law and because it is the fair thing to do.
Alistair Allen.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary. The bill is proceeding at pace through the Commons, and the more we discuss it, the more horrified those of us who believe in a compassionate global Scotland become. Will the Cabinet Secretary again confront the Tories on this monstrous bill, or the monstrous provisions in it, which could see women have no protection if they have been trafficked and children detained for the alleged crime of seeking sanctuary on this island?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, this restriction on the provision of support to human trafficking victims penalises some of society's most vulnerable people, those who've suffered unimaginable trauma, including sexual exploitation or being forced through violence to work for no pay in absolutely appalling conditions. These shameful proposals create additional barriers for trafficking victims, tightening the grip of perpetrators by reducing the likelihood of people seeking help. Children will also be left in an appalling position until they turn 18, where they will then be detained and removed to a third country where they have no connections and where they have no family. It is totally unacceptable.
And supplementary, Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The UK Government's illegal immigration bill means those arriving into the UK via illegal means are not eligible for asylum claims and will be detained on arrival in the UK. Dungible Immigration Removal Centre is Scotland's only detention centre. It can detain up to 130 men and 12 women. It will likely see a huge increase in the number of people detained here, as the process for securing successful asylum application will become much harder due to these restrictive rules. Will the Cabinet Secretary advise what action the Scottish Government is taking to liaise with the UK Government over this issue, as it is likely to completely overwhelm this detention centre in Scotland?
Well, can I say to Faisal Chowdhury, I think his question is really apposite. We perhaps might imagine that because some of the issues that are being dealt with by the UK government are very focused on people crossing the English Channel, that one might think that it is far away from here, that is an issue that perhaps may not touch us directly. But raising the point about the Dungavel facility, which of course is managed by the UK Home Office, it reminds us that this is something absolutely on our doorstep. So this is not only just a matter of human rights and supporting the principles of international law, justice and fairness, it's also something that will, unfortunately, given the plans of the UK government, be something that will also be reflected by institutions in Scotland, sadly, which we have no control over. So we're absolutely opposed to the legislation. And if ever there was a reminder was needed, that this Parliament should be in charge of immigration, this Parliament should be in charge of human rights, and we shouldn't leave it up to others to make bad decisions on our behalf.
Question number two, Daniel Johnson.
To ask the Scottish Government how much financial support it is providing to the third sector across Edinburgh and the Lothians to support refugees from Ukraine in the financial year 23-24.
Thank you, Mr Johnson. I would remind all members that they need to be here for 2 p.m. sharp. Neil Gray, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government recognises the tireless efforts of the community and voluntary sector in Edinburgh and My light's on. There we go, back. The tireless efforts of the community and voluntary sector in Edinburgh and the Lothians in supporting displaced Ukrainians. We continue to work closely with a number of community and voluntary sector organisations and have committed £200,000 to be shared between the Edinburgh Voluntary Organisations Council, Volunteer Edinburgh, Phoenix Counselling and Welcoming Association in Edinburgh. We're operating in a very challenging financial context for the next financial year, particularly given recent cuts to tariff funding made by the UK Government and the subsequent impact on local government. Government's ability to support displaced people from Ukraine.
Daniel Johnson.
Thank you very much. And Deputy Presiding Officer, please accept my apologies. I recognise that it's unacceptable. Can I just ask the Minister further to his question? The issues go beyond purely financial. Just this week, the Accords Human Rights Committee heard from refugees who were describing that the process to apply for ESOL is cumbersome and requires them to fill out detailed application forms in English, which it would be ironic if it weren't so tragic, given the imperative to provide English language training to people who recently arrived in this country from places like Ukraine. Can the Minister set out how the government intends to improve the situation?
Minister.
We obviously see support for English language ESOL classes as being a critical element of our response. We continue to work with local authorities who provide those services, our colleges and other training providers, as well as the UK Government in terms of the tariff provisions that it has provided. Of course, in the most recent budget, there was no additional support for the UK's humanitarian response for Ukraine. There has been a significant cut to the local authority tariff from £10,500 to £5,900. No year two funding whatsoever, and yet greater demands placed on our local authority partners by the UK Government in order to respond. We'll continue to make representations alongside our Welsh Government colleagues and local government partners across the UK for the UK Government to reconsider that so we can continue to do the good work around ESOL that we continue to set out.
Fiona Hislop, supplementary.
The warm Scottish welcome is something we can all be proud of as Ukraine's fight for freedom and democracy goes on. However, for our support to be maintained, we do need the UK Government to play its part. Can the Minister provide more detail on what effect the Chancellor's budget may have on Scotland's support for Ukraine?
Minister.
I thank Fiona Hislop for that question. The UK budget announced last week did nothing to reverse the funding cuts and support for people displaced by the war against Ukraine. In December, the UK government announced tariff funding for local authorities would reduce from £10,500 to £5,900 for those arriving after the 1st of January this year. They also confirmed there would be no year two tariff funding and the education tariff was being removed. This is not supporting displaced Ukrainians in the way anyone in this chamber or indeed the wider public would want. I think there's a wide acknowledgement that the UK Government has done a significant amount in terms of military aid and support. We have contributed £65 million in terms of military aid and support. It's time the UK Government matched that military support with humanitarian support and match the actions of the Scottish Government, which is what Scotland has welcomed a fifth of all UK arrivals from Ukraine, and ensure that humanitarian response matches that of military aid.
Question number three, Brian Whizzer.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Culture Minister has had with Historic Environment Scotland regarding the organisation's waste and resource plan, including any potential impact of the deposit return scheme on its operations.
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I engage regularly with Historic Environment Scotland to discuss its strategic plans and key developments. I have not discussed the deposit return scheme specifically with HES. I understand it is preparing to implement the scheme as an opportunity to increase levels of recycling in line with Scotland's national targets. I have asked Historic Environment Scotland to write to Mr Whittle with a detailed answer to his question regarding the potential impact of DRS.
Brian Hood.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Historic Environment Scotland has 9 sites with restaurants or cafes and over 70 sites with shops that could sell single-use drink containers, making them retailers and potentially return point operators. According to Historic Environment Scotland's waste resource plan, they must, and I quote, ensure they are compliant with their legal obligations and their obligations in relation to implementing the new deposit return scheme. Can the Minister tell me whether Historic Environment Scotland intends to purchase reverse vending machines at any of its sites, and how many of its sites have applied for and been granted an exemption?
Minister.
Thank you. Historic Environment Scotland is making preparations to implement the deposit return scheme in line with the launch date. Regarding impacts from a waste perspective and municipal waste, for example, household type waste, that is collected at HES sites, makes up about half of the waste it generates and is a waste stream where it has been struggling to increase recycling. So in 21-22, HES, I believe, recycled around 29% of this waste, despite having recycling on-the-go bins. So it hopes that the impact of the deposit return scheme will help to improve this rate and meet its waste targets, which are aligned to Scotland's national targets. But to give Mr Whittle some reassurance, I'm due to meet with Historic Environment Scotland tomorrow, and I'll raise the representations he's made with them tomorrow.
A supplementary, Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. In the deposit return scheme, visitor sites and venues will have no choice but to use the scheme's single logistics partner to collect return containers. But those sites and venues will also have existing contracts with other waste firms. Can the Minister guarantee that historic sites will continue with local businesses rather than the one owned by the American private equity firm?
Minister.
As I detailed to Brian Whittle, there has been no concern raised with me by Historic Environment Scotland around the implementation of DRS. Similar to the answer I gave to Mr Whittle, I'm happy to make representations on behalf of Mr Golden to Historic Environment Scotland when I meet them tomorrow and ensure that a full response, as detailed by myself to Mr Whittle, could be provided to Mr Golden as well.
Question number four, Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it is supporting the regeneration of cultural assets and venues in communities.
Minister.
The Scottish Government delivers a wide support for a variety of cultural assets and venues through funding of our public bodies, including Creative Scotland and Historic Environment Scotland. They in turn provide grant schemes like the Conservation Area Regeneration Scheme, which invests directly in local communities. We also support local authorities, businesses and communities to promote regeneration within towns through programmes including the Place-Based Investment Programme and the Vacant and Derelict Land Investment Programme and the Empowering Communities Programme.
Jenny Minto.
Thank you, and I thank the Minister for that answer. And I'm really glad that the Scottish Government recognises the importance of cultural venues in rural and island areas to the welfare and prosperity of Scotland's communities, despite an incredibly challenging economic climate. My constituents in Bute know this well, with rising construction costs threatening the remarkable regeneration of Rothesay Pavilion. What reassurance can the Minister give to community groups like those in Rothesay that culture will play a central role in Scotland's wellbeing economy?
Minister.
Thank you, President Officer. I thank Jenny Minto for that question. I can absolutely give that assurance to Jenny Minto and her constituents. The Scottish Government recognises the important role the Rothesay Pavilion plays in the culture, economy and life on Bute, which is why In 2015, the Regeneration Capital Fund awarded £625,000 to the project. We also demonstrate heritage support through sponsorship of Historic Environment Scotland, which has also contributed to funding towards this project. I've previously offered to meet with Argyll and Bute Council to discuss potential routes ahead, and I would also encourage the Council to continue engaging with other funders to explore other options. And I'd be more than happy to meet my colleague Jenny Minto at any time to discuss this.
And supplementary, Sarah Boyack.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Given the recent welcome press coverage that the campaign to save the Film House is still working to save this vital cultural asset, not just for cultural cinema in Edinburgh, but given its importance as the key venue for the Edinburgh International Film Festival over many, many years, can the Minister give us a commitment that the Scottish Government will do everything in its power to use its leadership to save this asset and bring it back into use, providing cultural cinema, jobs and new opportunities for young people going into the future?
Minister.
Yes, I can. I have to be very careful, as Sarah Boyack knows, that there is a legal process ongoing around the administration of CMI and therefore the Film House. I've tried my best within those confines to keep Sarah Boyack and colleagues updated as best I can. The Scottish Government is absolutely committed and has a very strong desire to see cultural cinema remain in Edinburgh, and we hope that the Administrator can take that into account.
And supplementary, Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to the Minister for his response about the Edinburgh film, the Film House Cinema. And I note what he says about the legal process, but does he have any indication of how long it will take to get through this process?
Minister.
I wish I did. It's out with of the Scottish Government's control, and my officials and public bodies that are involved continue to liaise as best we can with the process within the confines that we can. I reiterate that the Scottish Government is very clear and keen that cultural cinema is retained and that the building continues to be put to that fantastic use, for not just for the people of Edinburgh and the rest of Scotland, but for the equipment that's within it that is of significance across these isles.
Question number 5, Rosa Grant.
To ask the Scottish Government what it is doing to protect the culture of the Highlands and Islands.
Minister.
The Scottish Government is obviously doing everything that we can in order to ensure that we are providing the best possible response to ensuring we protect the culture of the Highlands and Islands. Our culture strategy celebrates and sets out our ambitions for nurturing culture and creativity across all of Scotland's communities. We support a range of organisations which enrich the cultural life of the Highlands and Islands, including Atlas Arts, the Highland Print Studio, Eden Court and many more. More broadly, the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs and the Islands announced a significant £4 million investment last year to ensure delivery of the National Islands Plan, which includes a strategic objective focused on supporting, nurturing and celebrating the arts, culture and language of our islands.
The Minister will be more than aware of the chronic issues that young people in the Highlands and Islands are facing. They have no choice but to leave to access jobs, housing and childcare. And this is having a devastating impact on the Gaelic language, our culture, as well as local services and economies. They want to stay, but they have no choice because they're priced out. They also face transport disruption, making it difficult to access health services and recreation. When will this government take action to provide affordable homes and boost the economy for the people who live across the Highlands and Islands to protect our culture and language?
Minister, I'll leave that to you too.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In terms of the culture response to ensuring that we provide support networks in the Highlands and Islands, I can give Sarah, to Rhoda Grant my assurance. I myself was born and brought up in Orkney, so I understand and recognise the picture that she paints in terms of the challenges that there are for our rural and island communities. My colleagues across government continue to invest in housing options, including the Rural Housing Assistance Programme. And in terms of the cultural investment that we do to help to incentivise people to stay, the regularly funded organisations that are supported in the Highlands and Islands, there are nine, over £2 million worth, including Eden Court, including Moniat Moore Writer Centre. In terms of the Culture Collective support that's been provided, £1 million to four organisations in the Highlands and Islands, we continue to recognise the importance that culture plays, including the Gaelic language, and the retention that that can hopefully help to provide.
And supplementary, Donald Cameron.
Thank you. I've raised concerns before with the Minister about the number of culturally important historic sites that remain either closed or partially closed by Historic Environment Scotland in the Highlands and Islands, including Kismul Castle on Barra and the Bonor Iron Furnace in Tainault. What action will the Minister now take to fast-track the reopening of these vital historic assets?
Minister.
In terms of Kismul Castle, it formed a large part of the discussion that I had with Historic Environment Scotland when I last met them recently, and I know from the assurances that the Historic Environment staff have given me that they are progressing as quickly as possible to ensure the safety of those sites is preserved, that the structural integrity is either preserved or enhanced, and that the reopening as quickly as possible happens, but putting the safety of staff and visitors first, which I'm sure Donald Cameron would agree has got to be the first priority.
And supplementary, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Does the Minister agree that for communities and their culture to thrive, access to affordable housing is indeed key? Recently, the Scottish Government invested £1,512,000 in helping Arran Development Trust to build 18 affordable homes on Arran. What further support will be provided to build more affordable homes in fragile Highland and Island communities?
Again, Minister, I will leave you to respond to the bits that come within your portfolio.
I've set out the work that we are doing from a culture perspective. I've tried to provide a supportive nod in terms of some of the work in housing that my colleagues are deploying in terms of the rural housing programmes. That would a good example that Kenneth Gibson has cited. We'll continue to provide that investment where our resources allow, because we absolutely value our rural and island communities continuing to be able to thrive.
Question number six, Bob Doris.
To ask the Scottish Government how its culture policies can help celebrate Scotland's rich social history.
Minister Neil Gray.
Our culture strategy celebrates the diversity and excellence of Scottish culture, past, present and future. For example, our Culture Collective programme, delivered by Creative Scotland and supported by over £10 million of Scottish Government funding to date, includes projects that celebrate local social history and empowers communities to shape and share the story of their place.
Bob Doris.
Thank you. Minister, St Andrew's Day this year marks the centenary of John McLean's death. A Red Clydesider jailed for his views in the First World War, who rallied against the British Empire, championed a free Ireland and an independent Scotland, lauded by Vladimir Lenin and inspired both Hamish Henderson and Matt McGinn to pen verse. Can I ask the Minister what role may there be for the Scottish Government, or indeed its agencies, to support the efforts of my constituents who would wish to use that centenary for Scotland to celebrate John McLean's contribution to a rich social history, and what funds may be available?
Minister.
Bob Doris makes an excellent case on behalf of such an important historical figure as John McLean. For Bob Doris and any others, I would encourage any community groups or organisations seeking to organise events of this kind to engage with our agencies and the many brilliant research resources we have available to us in Scotland. As a starting point, I would signpost to Creative Scotland, who offer a range of funding for both individuals and organisations, details of which are available on their website. Community groups may also wish to contact Historic Environment Scotland, the National Records of Scotland, as well as, in this case, Glasgow City Council's archives, to explore opportunities to carry out their own research in support of any celebrations they are planning. As plans develop, I would be happy to hear more and consider ways in which the Scottish Government might be able to be helpful and supportive.
Brief supplementary, please, Paul Sweeney.
Deputy Presiding Officer, scarcely a bigger icon for Scotland's social history in the Glasgow School of Art, yet we're almost 5 years on from the second disastrous fire there, with a predicted completion date of 2030. The Notre Dame Cathedral fire in Paris happened a year later, yet its rebuild is due to complete next year. With the news earlier this month that the tendering process for the McIntosh Building Restoration Project has collapsed, effectively putting the rebuild effort back to square one, will the Minister for Culture now instruct that the project be directly overseen by the Scottish Ministers in order to get the restoration of this international architectural icon back on track?
Minister.
Obviously, we recognise the cultural importance of the Glasgow School of Art, and Paul Sweeney will be well aware of the unfortunate history that there has been in terms of the renovation and restoration project there. It's been a difficult journey. It's one that we continue to support the restoration work and hope that it can be concluded as quickly as possible.
Okay, I could possibly squeeze in questions 7 and 8 if I get brief questions and brief answers to match. Question 7, Martin Whitfield.
Very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what steps it is taking to maintain relationships with Scotland's European neighbours post-Brexit.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government continues to engage both overseas and at home with ministers and delegations from across Europe. Our international network of offices also work to develop, maintain and strengthen relationships, attract trade and investment opportunities and create economic, social and cultural benefits for people in Scotland. Of course, rejoining the European Union would be by far the easiest and best way to maintain and to enhance these relationships.
Yeah. Martin Whitfield.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. There is no doubt that he's been working hard to build relationships across Europe following the 7 European countries visited last year. But the Scottish Government has made no progress on post-Brexit Erasmus scheme. In Wales, under Welsh Labour government, the first learners are already feeling the benefits of the TAFE scheme. So, Cabinet Secretary, could you confirm how many of the 8 visits to 7 European countries during 2022 he discussed a Scottish replacement Erasmus, and more specifically on the 5th of December, when he met with Dr. Manuela Beck of the Goethe Institute in Germany, could he outline the discussions regarding a Scottish TAFE scheme and any support that was offered?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm absolutely delighted to take the opportunity to confirm the many conversations that took place when I was in Berlin to discuss educational cooperation, not just with the Goethe Institute, but with the Scotland Hub in Berlin, and indeed the UK ambassador to Germany, and a number of German educational partners. It was noteworthy, however, that within a few short days, it became clear that the United Kingdom FCDO, the Foreign Office, had managed to agree an arrangement with the Federal Republic of Germany in relation to educational cooperation without any involvement whatsoever of the Scottish government. Ironic, because of course the German side managed to include the federal states, managed to include the Pädagogische Austauschdienst of the German Bundesländer, but managed to exclude Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland. If ever a timely reminder was needed that the UK government does not properly represent Scotland's devolved interests internationally, that is it. The best way to take part in Erasmus, as the member knows, is for Scotland to rejoin the European Union.
And question number 8.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government how it plans to celebrate and mark St Andrew's Day 2023.
Cabinet Secretary.
As our national day, St Andrew's Day is a special day for people in Scotland and around the world to come together and celebrate our country, our culture and our shared history. Final discussions are yet to be made on plans to celebrate and mark St Andrew's Day 2023, but we expect communities both at home and those with an affinity to Scotland across the globe to take the opportunity to celebrate St Andrew's Day and the Scottish values of kindness, compassion and solidarity.
And Paul McLennan, briefly, please.
Yeah, thank you. Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer? The cross-party group on St Andrew's Day, which I chair, will be in late April, be launching a call for evidence on realising the potential of our national day. Can the Cabinet Secretary advise what future plans the Scottish Government has to maximise the cultural, economic, faith and external relations opportunities of St Andrew's Day?
Cabinet Secretary, briefly, please.
Well, I look forward to reading the results of the consultation by the cross-party group, which does such valuable work. St Andrew's Day is Scotland's national day, a key moment for Scotland and those who feel an affinity with Scotland's culture. It's an opportunity for all of us individually and collectively to champion Scotland as an outward-looking and fair country, and the Scottish Government will continue to harness all of our networks to amplify this narrative and the shared values that underpin our national brand.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions on Constitution, External Affairs and Culture. And there'll be a very brief pause to allow front bench teams to switch seats. Thank you. Thank you. The next portfolio is Justice and Veterans, and again, if any member wishes to seek to request a supplementary, I would ask them to press their request to speak button during the relevant question or enter the letters RTS in the chat function. I call question number 1, Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it ensures that there is sufficient police presence throughout the North East.
Cabinet Secretary Keith Brown.
Policing is and will continue to be a priority for the Scottish Government. Scotland has a higher number of officers than at any time during the last administration and more per head of population than England and Wales, with 30 officers per 10,000 population in Scotland compared to 24 officers per 10,000 population in England and Wales. North East divisions have a core complement of officers who may be supported by specialist expertise and resources at a regional and national level should operational demand increase. Of course, the recruitment and deployment of resources is a matter for the Chief Constable.
Liam Kerr.
I thank the Minister for the answer, but Police Scotland is pressing on with plans to close Portlethen Police Station. And informed professionals warn that such a closure contradicts the joint strategy for policing, sends the wrong message to organised crime and leaves one of the North East's largest and fastest growing towns without a police station. Now, fears have been raised about how such a reduced police profile will have an impact on county lines drug dealing, and it risks throwing open the doors to Aberdeen City and our coastal communities. So will the Justice Secretary demand that Police Scotland look again at its closure plans and ensure local policing stays in Portlethen?
Cabinet Secretary.
No, I respect the operational independence of the Chief Constable, which of course is written into law in the Act which established Police Scotland. But I would say it is very important to recognise that one of the most important things to local communities and the detection and prosecution of crime is having enough police officers, well-paid police officers on the ground. And to that end, of course, having police officers that are paid at starting salaries of £5,000 more per year than they are in England and Wales is a very good point in order to do that. I would also say, of course, that is against the background of now 13 years of austerity from the Conservative Party. And one final word, if they could just listen for a second, one final word in relation to the size of the police force. If we were to have a police force of the size that the Tories have in England and Wales, it would be less than 14,000 officers, 2,600 officers less. So I'm confident that we're attaching the priority to policing resources that is required to deal with crime in Scotland.
And supplementary, Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Despite years of UK government austerity, it's very welcome that the Scottish Government have increased the policing budget by £80 million, a 6.3% increase on last year. How will the budget ensure police can respond to the changing nature of crime and continue to keep communities in Scotland safe?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the Member is, of course, right to say there's a change in nature of crime.
Excuse me, Cabinet Secretary, please resume. See, I'm in the chair. I decided the Member mentioned Scotland as a whole, which presumably includes the North East. Cabinet Secretary, please resume.
Thank you, President Officer. Just to say that, of course, there's a change in nature of policing, and I'm very keen to see the outcome of the meeting with the SPA and the Chief Constable tomorrow, which includes reference to enhanced emphasis on things like, for example, cybercrime and in relation to violence against women and girls. So from addressing incidents associated with vulnerability, including hate and domestic incidents, to dealing with the increasing complexity of crime in the digital age. Importantly, the £1.45 billion of funding in 23-24, which was not anything that was subject to an amendment by the Conservatives, that will support Police Scotland's leading work with communities on prevention and early intervention.
Question number two, Sarah Boyack.
To ask the Scottish Government how many police officers there currently are in the Edinburgh Divisional Area.
Cabinet Secretary.
I should say the Scottish Government is committed to working closely with the SPA and Police Scotland to support the delivery, first of all, of a joint policing strategy to ensure we continue to have safe, protected and resilient communities. Police engagement with the local authority in setting priorities and objectives for the policing of Edinburgh is crucial. I've said already that local deployment is a matter for the Chief Constable. Scotland's National Police Service allows local divisions across the country to access specialist expertise and resources at regional and national level, depending on demand. Police Scotland statistics indicate that 1,131 officers were in the Edinburgh Divisional Area on the 31st of December 2022.
Sarah Boyack.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his answer, but say, given the very worrying briefing from the Chief Constable, that as a result of this year's budget, hard choices will have to be made and that change will be needed. So can the Cabinet Secretary tell my constituents what he will do to protect not just the vital work of our police in our communities in Edinburgh and the Lothians, but the particular challenge of policing our capital city? And does the Cabinet Secretary accept we need additional police to tackle crime and keep people safe right across the city?
Cabinet Secretary.
I believe we need additional police, of course, to tackle crime across the whole of the country. And I would say that I've answered already in relation to the number of police officers, which, of course, is substantially higher than any time during the previous administration. Also, substantial improvements in terms of salaries for police officers. So we will continue to support the priorities which the police tell us are important to them. I've mentioned two of the ones which I expect to be discussed tomorrow. But I think in relation to this administration, and once again, we received no amendment to the budget which sought more funding for police during the budget process from the Labour Party. We will continue to support the police, and this year that will amount to £1.45 billion.
Question number three, Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what steps it is taking to ensure that children and young people know how to contact the police and other emergency services correctly.
Minister Elena Whittam.
Knowing how and when to contact our emergency services is a key skill that we want our children to have at the earliest possible age. In education, information around emergency services is delivered through health and wellbeing curriculum, and there is a range of material to assist teaching professionals delivering this learning. Furthermore, Police Scotland, the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service and the Scottish Ambulance Service work directly with schools and local authorities to ensure their role is widely understood among children and young people.
Evelyn Tweed.
Hanlon Stevenson from Winds of Milton was 2 years old when he called the police when his mum suffered a seizure in 2019. Hanlon has recently been awarded the Chief Constable's Bravery and Excellence Award in recognition of his bravery and swift action. Does the Minister join me in congratulating Hanlon and reinforcing the importance of children knowing the correct action to take in an emergency.
Minister.
The case of Hanlon Stevenson is truly remarkable, and I know that the Cabinet Secretary had the privilege of meeting this young hero at the Chief Constable's Bravery and Excellence Awards last month, where he and other members of the public were honoured for their quick thinking and courage. Hanlon's actions emphatically underline the importance of ensuring children and young people know what to do in an emergency. Schools, families, communities and our hard-working blue light services all have a role to play in ensuring how and when to call 999 is understood at the youngest possible age.
And supplementary, Russell Finlay.
Thank you. I also begin by congratulating heroic young Hanlon. Now, millions of 101 calls go unanswered, with almost one in four failing in the first 7 months of 2002. As the Chief Constable warns that Police Scotland's staffing levels can't be sustained, what's being done to ensure that when young people do need the police, they will be actually able to reach them?
Minister.
Following the pressures of recent years brought on by the global pandemic, Police Scotland have been very clear that they will prioritise 999 calls, and this is a position that the Scottish Government supports. The average answer time for 999 calls is around 5 seconds. For 101 calls, it's approximately 2 minutes. However, this is a non-emergency service, and throughout their wait, callers are reminded that if it is an emergency or an escalating situation, that 999 should be dialled. And this is something that I think all of our young people should understand.
Question number 4, Craig Hoy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what contact the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Veterans has had with the leadership team of Police Scotland since January 2023.
Cabinet Secretary.
I regularly meet with the Chief Constable and other members of his senior team. While the Chief Constable is, of course, accountable to the Scottish Police Authority, our meetings provide a valuable opportunity to discuss matters which are important to improving the safety and well-being of people, places and communities in Scotland. I also met this morning for two meetings with the Chief Constable and the Chair of the Authority as part of our schedule of regular trilateral meetings.
Justice Secretary is aware of Operation Branchform, Police Scotland's investigation into allegations of fraud within the SNP. Does Mr Brown share my concerns about the length of time this inquiry is taking, and is he aware of claims of operational interference within it? And as he is also Deputy Leader of the SNP, does he expect to be interviewed by Police Scotland as part of this investigation?
Cabinet Secretary, please deal with the matters for which you have ministerial responsibility.
The matters for which I have ministerial responsibility involve Police Scotland. I am not responsible for any investigations. I think the member knows that. He knows exactly what he's doing in relation to this. And I think it's reprehensible that we're seeing more and more of this evidence of things being referred to individual cases previously and now to an ongoing investigation. But obviously I can't comment on that, Presiding Officer.
Supplementaries from Daniel Johnson.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Last night, a cross-party group of MSPs met with whistleblowers from across the public sector, including former police officers. As the Cabinet Secretary will know my prior interest in these matters, I was just wondering what progress he's made in terms of his contact with both senior police leadership but also the SPA in terms of improving whistleblowing processes and ensuring that people are listened to, heard and their experiences acted upon within the police but indeed across the public sector.
Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, I think there were two things I would say, Presiding Officer, in relation to that question. One is, of course, there have been quite a substantial number of meetings and discussions following on from the meeting which Daniel Johnson refers to. Too long for me to indicate here, but I'm happy to write to the member with more detail on that. And of course, in addition to that, we'll be bringing forward legislation in due course which will have a very substantial impact on this area of policing, and the member will be consulted and have the opportunity to discuss issues at that time in relation to that proposal.
And supplementary, Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As we approach the 10-year anniversary of Police Scotland, it's important to recognise achievements since 2013, but it's equally as important to consider what the next steps of reform are. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that utilising evolving digital technologies like the DESC pilot in Dundee could make a big difference, particularly to police officer workloads?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think it's an excellent innovation, the DESC, Digital Evidence Sharing Capability Service. It represents a step towards a truly modern criminal justice system. It is, in the words of the police, the justice partners and, of course, the architects of the system, a world-leading system which places the needs of victims, witnesses and other users of the justice system at its heart. It represents, of course, an investment of £33 million over 10 years, which will make it easier to share evidence, allowing swifter access and helping cases to be resolved more quickly, reducing the risk of trauma to victims and to witnesses.
Question number 5, Ariane Burgess.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on how it is ensuring that legal aid funding is easily available to tenants in order to defend eviction proceedings.
Minister.
Civil legal aid is available to tenants of private and public landlords to oppose eviction proceedings. The usual tests of financial eligibility, probable cause and reasonableness apply. If an applicant's home is at risk, it is likely that they will satisfy the merits tests. There are also special urgency provisions in place which allow solicitors to take steps without needing the Scottish Legal Aid Board's prior approval to protect an applicant's position whilst a legal aid application is being considered. An eligibility estimator for civil legal aid is available on SLAB's website so that potential applicants can check whether they are likely to qualify financially.
Ariane Burgess.
I thank the Minister for her answer. Private tenants have their cases heard through the first-tier tribunal. Although this is intended to hear cases without legal representation, it's increasingly the case that landlords are seeking legal representation, especially in eviction cases. This leaves an imbalance if tenants have no legal representation. Does the Minister agree with me that this imbalance needs to be addressed, and what can be done to ensure tenants are aware of their rights and can access legal aid when and where they need it?
Minister.
When a landlord serves notice to leave, this clearly states that the tenant may wish to contact a solicitor and that legal aid may be available to them. Solicitors and the Scottish Legal Aid Board can also give advice about entitlement and about making an application. The Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service website also contains advice on representation at hearings. It is also important to underline that there are many organisations that can help when defending an eviction case. The Civil Legal Assistance Office represents tenants on a daily basis. Free advice and assistance may also be available from Citizens Advice Scotland, the Scottish Association of Law Centres, and court advisers or sheriff clerks' offices.
Question number six, Jim Fairley.
Thank you, President Officer. I'd like to ask the Scottish Government how its proposals for criminal law to address misogyny will challenge misogyny in society.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Government believes that reform of the criminal law on misogyny can help to encourage men to change their behaviour by sending a clear message about what is criminally unacceptable behaviour. Our consultation is seeking views on new laws which will specifically criminalise misogynistic harassment and sending threatening or abusive messages about rape, sexual assault or disfigurement to women and girls, for example. However, as I made clear during the recent debate on misogyny, new criminal law will not achieve cultural change on its own. We will continue to focus on tackling wider gender inequality and taking forward action in schools to address gender-based violence and sexual harassment.
Jim Fairley.
I'd like to thank the Cabinet Secretary for the answer. 2 weeks ago, during the International Women's Day debate, this Parliament was at its best as members from across the chamber stood together and openly discussed their experiences and expressed their outrage at the existing misogyny in Scotland society. Now, in my speech during the public transport debate, I raised the story about Lorraine Kelly, whose daughter lived in Singapore and would have to adapt simple behaviours such as walking home alone now that she'd returned to the UK. What lessons can the Scottish Government learn from other countries to permanently change misogynistic behaviour and culture?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I agree, first of all, with Jim Fairley about the extent to which men can be ignorant of the way in which young women, young girls, have to adapt their behaviour because of the behaviours of men from a very early age? And it's right that it's highlighted so that men are more aware of that. I think it's very important that we consider best practice from around the world and look at how we can learn from what other countries have done to address misogynistic behaviour and change deeply ingrained cultural attitudes, both in terms of the law and other measures to achieve lasting cultural change. And just to say that the misogyny bill, if it results in legislation, is likely to be world-leading legislation, and for that reason I hope we can get support from across this chamber for that legislation.
A supplementary, Jamie Green.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Unfortunately, one of the ways many women experience misogyny is through interaction with the criminal justice system itself. We've all heard stories of how the whole process re-traumatises them, and they're often met with very outdated views on their allegations of abuse, domestic violence and, unfortunately, rape as well. Can I ask if the upcoming Criminal Justice Reform Bill that the Government plans to introduce may be used as an appropriate vehicle to improve those negative interactions, and when might the Parliament see some sight of that legislation?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, all I can say is that we very soon that legislation will be coming forward, and also confirm to Jamie Green that it will do exactly what he says. It recognises, not throughout the system, but in the areas that we'll touch upon, that we can re-traumatise people coming forward, especially women coming forward, especially for sexual crimes, and we have to make sure that we extinguish that re-traumatisation so they legislation when it comes forward. I hope Jamie Green will be able to support it. Will, in a number of ways, and he will know from previous the consultation that we had on the bill about the ways that we previously intended it should do exactly as he describes. And I hope he'll be satisfied when he sees that bill very soon that it does exactly what he hopes.
A supplementary, Katie Clark.
Two-thirds of respondents to a survey carried out by the working group said that the misogynistic behaviour they had experienced was online. But online misogynistic harms, such as revenge porn or sexual bullying, are absent from the Scottish Government's digital strategy. Will the Cabinet Secretary look at this and consider how this can be addressed?
Cabinet Secretary.
To respond directly to the member, of course we will look at this, but the member will be aware that the bulk of the powers in relation to online harms come under reserve legislation. That is currently being looked at by the UK Government. We are fully engaged with that. We are relatively, in fact, almost fully supportive of what the UK Government intends to do. If there's more that we can do here, then of course we're happy to look at that.
Question number 7, Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what its most recent analysis is of the provision of legal aid found in relation to geographic area and types of cases covered.
Minister.
The Scottish Legal Aid Board's most recent annual report shows that the number of grants of civil legal aid in 2021-22 was slightly above the long-term 5, 10 and 15-year averages. Within this total, there has been significant growth over time in working relating to adults with incapacity, primarily guardianship applications and renewals, partly offset by a reduction in other types of cases, including family law and personal injury, the vast majority of which are now undertaken on a no-win, no-fee basis. To assist with its work to monitor accessibility and availability of legal services, SLAB has recently begun a research project aimed at exploring how trends in legal aid activity at the sub-national level compare to the national trend and vary between areas of law. The research will analyse data relating to the location of the applicant, solicitor and court, and SLAB intends to publish the full results of its analysis when it is completed.
Maggie Chapman.
I thank the Minister for that response. She will be aware that many organisations that support those seeking legal aid have identified significant inequities of service provision. They cite high workloads, failure to attract and retain solicitors to legal aid provision, as well as not-fit-for-purpose delivery and funding models as key barriers to access to justice. Given the Evans review was 5 years ago, can the Minister provide assurances that these issues will be addressed in this parliamentary term? And does she think that we should treat legal aid like a public service?
Minister.
Since 2019, there have been three uplifts across all legal aid fees, £10 million in other funding in 2021, including 40 traineeships, plus a further £11 million package of reforms to be implemented in May. We are also committed to working with the legal profession to develop an effective and evidence-based mechanism for keeping legal aid fees under review. Therefore, there has been considerable work undertaken since the Evans Review to support and reform legal aid. The Scottish Government consulted on potential legal aid reforms before the pandemic and will be undertaking further targeted engagement to progress the manifesto commitment on legal aid reform this year. Access to legal aid is an important aspect in supporting individuals to claim their rights through the courts and should rightly be recognised as an invaluable public service. It is also important to try and build consensus around a reformed system of legal aid, and that is why, along with the Law Society of Scotland and the Faculty of Advocates, I will be co-chairing a working group to holistically look at the future of the legal profession in Scotland. This deep dive is critical going forward.
Brief supplementary, Paul McLennan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Scotland has one of the best legal aid systems in Europe, both in terms of spend per capita, eligibility and scope. What steps are the Scottish Government taking to build on our generous system and ensure that there is fair access to justice for all those who need it?
Minister.
As I've confirmed, the Scottish Government will be undertaking further targeted engagement to progress the manifesto commitment on legal aid reform this year. Such engagement is necessary to further inform the consultation exercise for legal aid reform in 2019. It is important to recognise the post-COVID justice landscape and user need, which has seen much greater adoption of technology by users, courts and legal aid providers. It absolutely should also be recognised that despite economic downturns and other global challenges, the Scottish Government has retained the wide scope of legal aid in contrast to many other jurisdictions where this has been significantly curtailed.
And brief supplementary, Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. What support can the Scottish Government give to domestic abuse organisations in rural and island areas to ensure fair and equitable access to legal aid?
Minister.
The Scottish Government's Violence Against Women Unit funds a linked project that employs advocacy workers, a project coordinator and admin support that funds the delivery of national helpline. Both projects are interdependent and the advocacy workers acting as initial points of contact prior to help from a local solicitor.
And question number 8, Siobhan Brown, who's joining us remotely. Ms Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I ask the Scottish Government what analysis has been carried out of recorded crime in South Ayrshire?
Cabinet Secretary, if you heard that, please respond.
Heard loud and clear, Presiding Officer. The latest figures show a 43% reduction in recorded crime across South Ayrshire under this administration. That includes a 69% fall in housebreaking and a 73% fall in vandalism. And this decrease reflects wider improvements across Ayrshire, where the proportion of adults who were the victim of a crime, including those not reported to the police, fell from 24% in 2008-09 to 10% in the years immediately prior to the pandemic. And looking ahead, we will build on this encouraging progress through investing £1.45 billion in policing across Scotland in 2023-24.
Siobhan Brown.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer and the welcome news. The Scottish Government's recorded crime statistics for 2021-2022 show an increase of people threatening to or disclosing intimate images of others, not only in South Ayrshire, but across Scotland. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me these threats or revenge porn is a serious crime? And can I ask what analysis has the Scottish Government undertaken to determine the reasons behind this increase?
Cabinet Secretary.
I agree, first of all, that sharing intimate images of others without their consent is a serious crime. There was an excellent programme on TV this week about a very courageous young woman that took this case, a case of this, to court very successfully. And, of course, this was raised by Katie Clark a short time ago. The Parliament legislated to make it a specific criminal offence, punishable by up to 5 years' imprisonment. The offence is often committed online, and we've been working hard to push, as I've said, the UK Government to strengthen their online safety bill to help tackle this kind of activity. Also, our Delivering Equally Safe Fund provides £110,822 to the South West Grid for Learning Trust to help support its revenge porn helpline and to further its work to get illegal intimate images removed from the internet. This funding demonstrates the Scottish Government's commitment to challenging all forms of violence against women and girls.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions on justice and veterans. There will be a very short pause before the next item of business to allow members to change position should they wish. Thank you.